You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Laura House joins us. It's week number 7, still hot and furious. We're in love.
Yeah. Yeah. Wait. Who?
Week 7.
Yeah. I'm in, it's week 7 of this relationship. It's going very well.
You're in Hollywood and you're in love.
In Hollywood, two unicorns found each other. It's wonderful.
He's a trumpet player?
Yes, he's a professional jazz trumpet player. He's about to go to Europe to tour with an orchestra in Amsterdam and London, which I say this because I'm bragging. It sounds very fancy. Then he's going to Ireland to meet an artist that he enjoys. So he's just going to meet him, which I find very deep and fancy. And then he's coming back and he's doing some shows in Las Vegas with Kevin Eubanks.
Mm.
So this dude's got it going on.
And he plays with Oingo Boingo.
And he plays with Oingo Boingo.
And he plays with your Oingo Boingo.
Oh, kazoo! as much as possible. What?
7 weeks? Sometimes
I'm like, more Oingo, less Boingo. if you know what I mean. And like, nobody really knows, but you just kind of try to figure out the context. There was a fun thing that we did a couple of weeks ago where it was a work thing for him. And he was like, hey, will you go with me to this work thing? This other musician's been inviting me and I don't really know what it is. I'm not going to know anybody there. And I was like, yeah, of course. And then he sent me, he goes, here's the invite. And it was like, Time with Deepak Chopra. And I was like, hey, do you know who this is? And he was like, oh, he's a writer, right? And I was like, oh boy. So just to explain to someone who Deepak Chopra is, and like, yes, he is a writer. Yes, he's written like 80 books, but he's this doctor meditation guy and on Oprah a lot. Do you know who Oprah is? Like, then you're just like, What do you not know?
I'm just breathing deeply whenever you say Deepak.
Oh, yeah. No, there you go. Yeah. His name has that effect of like, oh, you know what? I didn't really hear the details because I was just like floating.
Yeah.
So I went to this small party. It was like a CD listening party. I mean, there was live performances and Deepak Chopra led a guided meditation.
Wow.
And I got a picture with them, which I was embarrassed to do, but I was also like, if I, as literally a professional meditation teacher, poo-poos the opportunity to get a picture with mm-hmm. Deepak Chopra, I'm a real dummy.
Yeah. Was he nice?
Yeah, he was nice, but it was also just kind of I think the people there, because it was music related, it was like Grammy voter related. And so my boyfriend still isn't sure why he was invited, but we had a nice time. He was like, I don't know why if someone thinks I vote for the grant, I don't really know. But anyway, the guy who was behind it all was like, is a big fan of my boyfriend or whatever. So he invited him and it was great. And, it's like a new age album is coming out that, Deepak sings on.
Yeah, it's being produced by Biggie Smalls people. I'm thinking Tupac.
Tupac Chopra. Yeah. No, well, you know, Deepak, they've got West Coast, East Coast meditation. The gang signs are like, you know, when you have to hold your hand when you meditate. This is a better bit in person.
I hear a West Coast meditation never stops.
Yeah. No, there ain't no meditation like a West Coast meditation. A West Coast meditation takes you all the way into the beyond. Yeah.
So does he drink at parties, Deepak?
I didn't see him drink. But also, it wasn't a nighttime party. It was like a 5 to 7 CD listening performance thing. There was like a guide. There wasn't alcohol there, so I wouldn't know. But he's allowed to drink. Do you think he can't drink if he wants to?
I'm just curious if you can get that in touch with the universe. Do you need alcohol?
Maybe you just enjoy out. Maybe you just enjoy some wine or something.
Do you ever meditate?
I don't know. I don't know why you're taking a stand on this.
Do you ever meditate high?
Do I?
Yeah.
Well, David, you just hit upon a whole new topic that I'm glad to talk about. In 8 days, I'll be 10 years sober.
Congratulations.
Thanks. So no, I don't meditate high. I have, I guess. We're early on, but
we should mention that you are one of the world's leading TM somethings. Meditators?
Yeah. Not TM, but I do meditate and teach meditation. I don't know that I'm one of the leading meditators.
I heard you're one of the top meditators.
No, I people come from far and wide just to watch me meditate. Look at the technique, the way she closes her eyes.
And you have a podcast where you help people meditate.
Yeah, I have a podcast called Will You Med With Me? Which I like the name, but maybe it doesn't make sense. But maybe it will in a year or two.
How often do you do it?
For like med. How often do I meditate or do the podcast?
Both.
I meditate every day, usually twice a day. And the podcast, I'm less disciplined about. I try to put out one a week, but I took like a little time off. But I put one out last week, so it behooves me to put another one out this week. It's hard to do. How have you done it consistently for years?
I'm a moron.
Oh, okay.
I have no pride.
Okay. I just hope people understand, whoever's listening to me, that like, hey, I don't know. I didn't. I just didn't do it sometimes.
You don't have like a hard and fast deadline that you stick to?
No, because I don't. There's nothing motivating it. Like,
what about your listeners?
Yeah, there are some people who listen to it, but I don't really. They're not really in touch with me. Like, you know, no one is like, hey, where's your podcast? Or like nobody's, it doesn't seem to bother anyone if I make it or if I don't. So I just kind of like.
Do you ask people to communicate with you?
I teach usually comedians or writers, funny writers.
No, I'm saying on your podcast, do you say, go to my website, hit the contact button?
No, I hear what you're saying. And now I guess, no, I don't do that. I guess I should.
I do it, which is why you're on the show. People love you.
Okay, so, but not you.
I wouldn't otherwise be
on the show.
I do what my listeners tell me to do.
Wow. All right. You hear that, listeners? Tell them some weird stuff to do.
So they may be pranking me, but you're one of our most requested guests.
It's time to recommend Jell-O in the underwear. Do a whole show with Jell-O butt.
Hey, get a website for your podcast. I would assume you already do have a website for your podcast, right?
I mean, I have larahouse.com, and then it has all my stuff on it.
Well, when you do your podcast, tell me what you like, tell me what you dislike. They will communicate with you, and you will discover, unless you ask, your listeners aren't going to tell you that they're listening to you. And this way, you have a dialogue with them, and it's a perfect relationship because it's personal but not too personal. You know, I like talking to my listeners. I really do.
Do you ever hit on them?
I don't want to spoil the fantasy. They are convinced that I'm a 58-year-old man with hair transplants. doing the show in a blue Oxford button down and baggy khakis from Brooks Brothers.
Oh, I see.
Freshly shaven, except around the face.
Oh, wait, but...
I shave my legs for every podcast.
Okay, that's nice.
That's what the BBC used to do. The BBC had a long tradition. They would wear tuxedos when they stood in front of a microphone, and they shaved their legs. I think they learned that at Eton.
Okay.
Were you intimidated by Deepak? Did you talk to him? Did you tell him that you're, you know, doing his thing? That whole Eastern philosophy?
First, it's not his thing. It's been around. I mean, it's a thing he's made zillions of dollars promoting, as well as other things. But it's not his thing. It's an ancient tradition predates language.
It's so an ancient Chinese secret, or is that rice-a-roni?
Kind of. I know that was a laundry. That was like all temperature.
Oh. Okay.
But and rice-a-roni. I guess there's a lot of secrets in everything. No, he wasn't intimidating at all, which was nice. I mean,
I teach intimidation.
Okay, intimidating meditation.
Intimidation.
Uh huh.
Where you tell the universe to go F itself and threaten it.
How does that work? Is that relaxing?
It gets your juices going.
Okay. Okay. So not relaxing. All right. No, that's fun.
You were saying something about Deepak.
No, he seemed very regular. It's, you know, mostly like a guy like that is at this point. I mean, I don't know if he put on more of a persona early on to kind of get like Americans really respond to like, oh, this guy's important. And anything that's sort of like, if we put it in a spiritual context, then we, I think, mentally, culturally associate it with religion, which a lot of us were like, I was raised Episcopalian. And of course there's Catholic where like,
Episcopalian,
oh, you know,
is that like a real religion or is that just a thing to get into a country club and keep everybody else out?
Episcopalian? No, they would never. They don't belong to country clubs. They're like Lutheran, but Catholic-ish. It's like Catholic light. Like it's not. That sounds like a Protestant thing, like what you just described.
Is Episcopalian the closest we have to Anglican?
Yes, it's Anglican. One Episcopalian church I went to was called Anglican Catholic. Which in college, once I got to college, I was like, that you can't call it that. That doesn't make any sense.
It would be the closest.
The Church of England. It's the Church of the Queen of England.
So it would be the closest to Catholicism because it's Henry VIII's breakaway religion.
It's his, yes, I can get a divorce religion.
And the priests can have sex.
Yeah, I mean, not in front of everybody. Like, they're not like, look how open. But yes, they can be married and stuff.
And is there an epidemic of altar boys being touched?
Not that has been revealed.
So there's not a scandal of...
No.
Priests touching little
No, boys. There's not much excitement around Episcopalianism at all. So it was not a scandal, hey, service starts at 10.
How long are the services?
You know, an hour. So I feel like Episcopalians know they can't get away with holding you in there for very long.
Do they have confession?
No. Some of them might. Mine didn't because that was part of why I left. I was like 12 and I had seen like confession and stuff on TV and I didn't realize that was just Catholic, but because it looks really similar to Episcopalian. Mm-hmm. So I asked the priest like, hey, can I do confession? I don't know what I had done that I felt really bad about, but something, I'm sure. And I was like, can I do confession? He said, oh, we don't really do that, but you can, you know, pray to Mary, you know, that and have Jesus as the intercessor and take it to God. And I was like, what? It seemed like a weird game.
Sounds like going to the DMV.
Yeah, it sounded like a weird game of telephone, I felt like.
I'm sorry, you're in the wrong line. You want to speak to Jesus. Why didn't you tell me that?
Don't speak directly to Jesus. Fill out this form, then Mary gives it to Jesus, and then he'll sort through and he'll pass on what he feels is important to God. Oh, the same God that you keep telling me in Sunday school loves me, blah, blah, blah? Like,
well,
I can't leave that dude a message. So I became Baptist. But my point is,
did you become Baptist?
I became Southern Baptist. Like, I got real religious.
How'd that happen?
It was people at my school in junior high, like Cindy Jackson. She went to the First Baptist Church, and I went to, like, you know, they recruit people. Like, that's part of the deal of, like, First Baptist Church is like, if you don't believe exactly this, you go to hell. Like, if you don't believe precisely this and Jesus is your savior and you specifically invite Jesus into your heart, you will burn forever in a literal fiery hell.
I like that.
It's very clear. They're not like, well, Methodist, that's basically the same, or whatever. I don't even know how they feel about Methodist, but they're like, no, no, this is the one thing. And, but they also have that, like, Jesus is your friend, like, Jesus is everywhere, and you talk to Jesus all day, and I liked that.
Make for obedient family members?
Yeah, because it's the fire and brimstone kind of stuff.
I like that. I think I would have been a happier man.
I liked it. I liked it in junior high. Like, that was my rebel, because my parents were like, what are you doing? Because they drink and stuff. They were like, this is crazy, but I don't know, you find your way through life somehow. And that's what I really, I liked. And then, but it was also very social. Like, they had, like, a gym, and, like, they had Wednesday night church and youth group stuff, and you went on mission trips and choir trips, and, you know, so it was a very, like, youth active thing. So I that I'm sure appealed to me as well.
But they were homophobic.
Yeah. I didn't know what that was until I went to college. I didn't know what anything was until I went to college.
And they made you feel guilty about sex.
Well, you weren't to have sex before you were married.
And were you allowed to have sex for enjoyment after you were married?
Yeah. Yeah, there was actually, like, they did a youth group, you know, sex talk one day or whatever. And this married couple, they were like, this is totally to be enjoyed for married people, just not outside of marriage, not before marriage. And it's not safe to do that. And it's not safe for your soul, because the idea is that when you make love with a person, your souls unite forever. So you can't just do that with a lot of people. Like, what a mess. what a mess that'll be in heaven.
Does any of that make sense? How do you explain to people in the 21st century that there's a reason they teach that?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it makes sense, like, lots of beliefs of, like, you know, you believe this one thing and then little by little you accept the details, you know.
Well, let's talk about sex.
Oh, okay, sure.
Everybody thinks sex isn't that important until it's time to have it.
Oh.
Right?
Do people not think it's important? I mean,
in this country, it's like, what's the big deal? It's just sex. Come on, lighten up. And then when it comes time to actually get naked and have the sex, there's a pamphlet that you have to read, and you have to go out over the manual and make sure you understand all the parts.
Who are you dating? A pamphlet?
A Ford Fiesta.
Um, was it? I can't even pull off this joke. Was it Thomas More who made the pamphlets to talk about? Who was the economist?
Oh, Luther. Martin Luther. Where are we going with this?
I'll come back in an inappropriate amount of time with
pamphlets. Payne.
Yes, Thomas Paine. See there. What are you dating, Thomas Paine? See, that would have been. But I could. I was like Thomas More, and the. I didn't pull it off. I'm sorry, everybody.
Yeah.
Don't tell David you hate me.
These are the bits that try men's souls.
So there's a pamphlet and you have to know the... Okay, so what's your point with we act like sex isn't a big deal, but you're saying it's very hard and you can't do it?
Well, if it's hard, I can do it.
Hey-o.
We'll be right
back. But you're saying sex is too difficult and you're not any good at it.
What? No, I'm not. I'm saying that everybody in America, in America has this... It's just sex. It's just sex. But it's not just sex.
I feel like everyone in America, like on the surface at least, like freaks out about sex.
No, it's the other way around.
We're talking about in different ways. I feel like it's in Europe that they're like, "It's what are you so weird about?" or whatever.
Right. I think the Europeans have sex. I think they're like bonobo monkeys. And I think in the United States, all we do is talk about sex. We're obsessed with sex. We like to pretend it's not that important. But the minute...
Oh, I see.
The minute it turns to sex, it gets important. Suddenly, the relationship takes on a new meaning.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Like you don't look at other people now. We've had sex. That's sort of like, I've had sex with you, so like now I can make a lot of rules. Is that the idea that you're...
Maybe.
Are you in that area?
Are you in that area?
Are you in that area?
Is that you?
Are you in the area of pants?
I'm not talking about your current relationship.
Yeah. No, I get in that area. Sure.
I have a theory that...
Because my last relationship, he never really... committed. I mean, you kind of have to, ideally you establish all that before you have sex with them. And if you can't trust them enough that like, hey, this person is with you, then don't have sex with them and don't date them anymore. But no, my last, it was very trying because it was like, he always seemed, you know, he was very flirty and sort of things with other people.
That's not good.
Yeah. And I felt like, yeah. And then you just, it's bad. It's a bad feeling.
Flirting with other women. Like, I completely shut down my flirt machine. And then I quit drinking.
Oh,
so I have no game with women whatsoever. Because yeah. If you're not drinking and you're not by nature a flirt, it's...
But you're funny, so that's a great amount of game. I'll tell you this, because my current guy would describe himself similarly. He can drink, but he doesn't drink a lot. But he would describe himself as like, I don't have any game. He would be like on dates like, this is as much game as I have. I don't really. But like, he was just charming by being nice. And then he's funny. You're fine.
I don't like to do the Katherine Hepburn, Spencer Tracy back and forth.
What do you just want to hit somebody with a club over the head and go do it?
Well, that is doing it for me. I'm done.
What do you, so you don't like banter?
I like laughing, but you know, I don't know. I don't want to do the wordplay.
Okay.
It just feels unnecessary.
Do you date?
Maybe.
All right.
I don't know. I was going to make a bet. I can't. You know what? No. I'm too old. No, I can't. I call it dating.
Oh.
I'm not going to go there. I could say
she calls it customer who stands in line too long at Starbucks talking to me.
I was going to go with she calls it customer, period.
Yeah, we went to the same. Oh, customer. Oh, hookers. I see.
Well, maybe. No, I
I had you a customer at Starbucks, which is less gross. Is it?
I don't know anymore.
Or is it?
I don't know.
So stupid.
Casual sex. This is my theory about casual sex.
Uh-huh.
There is such thing as casual sex, but not for both people.
Oh, somebody inevitably likes the other one?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think there's casual sex for... you know what? I have a question that let's get into this topic neither of us know anything about. I don't know anyone who engages in casual sex or claims to enjoy it who isn't kind of an emotionally broken person, boys and girls. No, girls. I guess there are some, I think of some boys, I know some comedian boys who have like come to some kind of terms with, you know, they have sex. Sometimes it's no big deal. But for the most part, it's sort of broken boys and girls who are like, no, no, it's like almost like, no, no, it's fine. Like almost like, honestly, on my deepest level, I've decided I'll never really fall in love with someone. So I, you know, but I'm not a monk either. So I'm just going to, you know, I have sex with people like no big deal, but really.
You don't think you can fall in love with somebody.
But really it hurts. No, no, I do. I'm saying that casual sex havers and when I have looked for that or done it, that was where I was coming from, was like, you know, on the surface, it was like, yeah, who cares? It's just sex, whatever. But deep down, it was, I don't think anybody's really going to love me anyway. Like, I don't think I'm going to get that, like some great relationship. So I might as well do this. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Do you think that who's having casual sex? Or do you think there are people who are like, look, I love myself. I like myself. One day I'll have a relationship. I'm not interested in that now. And sometimes I'm attracted to people and we have sex and everything's fine.
I don't know. I'm just trying to figure out how to wedge in a autoerotic asphyxiation reference. I think I have one. I hate when I'm wearing suspenders and a woman has to have casual sex with me and I don't have a belt to wrap around my neck. So, all right.
Well, yeah. it was pretty good, Dave. But do you think that it's just broken people having casual sex?
Well, I get into trouble with women because there is a theory that I've heard from men, professors, who claim that women who, well, it's been disproven, but there's this guy who I had on the show who says that women who jump from bed to bed tend not to have orgasms, and they're working out some kind of issue that has nothing to do with pleasure. That's what I was told, but I don't know. And then I've been told by women, we like going from bed to bed and having sex with strangers. I'm staying out of it. I don't want to get into trouble. So,
well, I guess the truth, David, is that different people have sex for different reasons.
But all women are the same, right?
Find some sweeping. No, all women are the same.
Right?
Yeah, no, for sure. As much as I've, because I was a young person and the Sex and the City show was telling us we should be good at sex and we should get to have it and everything's fine. And,
you know what? Sex and the City should be good at writing jokes. I mean, they build entire scenes based on a pun.
Yeah, no, that's for sure. But yeah, so I was like, yeah, I want to be like that. But I don't know. I guess I just know for me personally, like, I'm not really made that. Like, I wanted to be like that. It seemed cool.
Do you think all men are the same?
No, God, no, no.
Ask me a question about men. I can answer any question about men.
I don't have any questions about men.
Do you think gay men have to read books about picking up other men? Is there a guide to picking up men for men? I don't know.
I'd have to ask my a gay friend.
Do you think there's ever been a, and this is a terrible sweeping generalization, do you think there's ever been a gay man who has said, I have no game?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, I think there are insecure gay men and shy gay men. And yeah, I don't think every gay man is like, you know, oh, I love music that sounds like, I don't think they're all the same. Like, love the gym and, you know, whatever. Yeah. In fact, a gay friend of mine said to me recently, he was like, I want a boyfriend, but I'm like, I don't feel great about my body right now. So I don't know. I'm just a little lonely or whatever. Like, that's not in your stereotype.
Interesting.
And I think there's also straight men who, so is your idea kind of like men just want to have sex, and if a woman approaches them to have sex, they're like going to go for it? Is that what you were going for?
I don't know. I'm just throwing. I'm afraid to say anything.
All right. Well, forget it.
I was watching.
This is a bad topic if it's the one thing you're afraid to say something.
No, about. I just went to the Gay Pride March in my shorty shorts and my tank top.
Yeah.
And I was looking.
Did you have a rainbow painted on your chest?
Because yes. That'd be fun. Yes.
Okay. And yes, obviously.
And a pot of gold. Okay, so I'm looking at everybody, and they're pretty happy, and they're fun.
Sure.
And they're sexual. I guess that's not every gay person.
But, no, it's not.
But the preponderance of people marching are strutting their stuff, and I was just wondering, I doubt there are any books for gay men on how to pick up guys. I don't think they have a problem. But that's prejudicial, and that's based on a stereotype that gay men are hypersexed, which is not true.
Maybe a stereotype, but that may just be based on a fantasy of, like, you know, we can kind of fantasize, like, oh, like, life is easy for other people. Like, I always had, like, you know, oh, beautiful women, they don't have these problems. You know, like beautiful women are like dumped all the time or used or whatever else. But like, as a normal looking, let's say, woman, you can be like, oh, but if you're really beautiful, it's easier. Or like, oh, if you're richer, then life is easier or whatever. So I think it's almost like magical thinking that, like, well, gay guys, you know, it's hard for straight guys to get said it was easy for gay guys. I just think, like, that's probably not entirely true.
Well, actually,
but let's hear it from our callers. We'll take caller 10.
Would think before the parades it must have been impossible for gay men to flirt for fear of being hurt.
Yeah, I mean, there's movies about that.
Yeah, I think that explains the celebration and why some of them are so flamboyant.
Yeah, no, for sure, because they were told to be quiet for so long, and you couldn't. Yes, it comes out very loud now, but also, you know, like, you're looking at.
Can I just speak to that for a second? Because
hey, it's your show.
Unfortunately, I wish it was. I know everybody listening remembers when you used to host this thing.
Yeah, remember when it was me and Jerry Stahl?
Good times.
Good times.
I would think if it's the 1950s, you're gay and you see a guy, he's conflicted and there's some kind of flirtation going on. I would say 90% of the time, one of the two chickens out and says, what are you looking at? What? What did you? And then there's a punch through. Right? I would think that happened a lot.
Sure. Yeah. And I would think, yeah, I would think there's a lot of confusing.
And I think that is why there's this flamboyance. So there's no doubt. It's like, I am gay. I am gay. Come on to me. I'm going to come on to you. Let's be upfront here. So there's no bait and switch here. I think that's why there's a tendency to flaunt it now.
Sure. Okay. I get that. But I cannot wait for the listener of yours who takes the soundbite, I am gay, that you just gave us, mm-hmm. and makes it their ringtone. That's what I'm most excited about in my life right now.
I wish there was conversion therapy to turn men gay. Because I would take it.
That's a fun... see, that's how you're a comedy writer. That's a fun sketch.
Well, I'm being serious here. I think my life would be easier right now.
But I know, but I think a lot of people would feel that way. Also, it's very funny of like, yeah, I'd rather have that life. That looks like fun.
Well, I understand men. Even gay men, I understand. Women, I cannot figure out.
Well, why don't you treat each of us as individuals and just try to figure out one that you like a lot?
You mean treat a woman like a human being?
Yeah.
That would be like treating my cat like a dog.
Okay, you know what? Well, that just makes no sense.
But I don't think men and women are, I don't think we're the same type of human being.
Well,
do you?
I mean, everybody wants to be loved. So
right.
After that, it's just details, right?
Yeah, but I think that men and women are profoundly different. Don't you?
I don't know. I feel like there's so many types of people that I feel like if you're...
All right, let me ask you a question.
If you're heterosexual, like as a heterosexual woman, I need to find a heterosexual man that like makes a match with me in a way that feels good to both of us. And I feel like if you're homosexual... woman, you find a homosexual woman who is a match with you. It's and some aren't and some are. And you know what I mean? Like,
Let me ask you a question.
All right.
Have you ever fantasized in LA traffic? You see a handsome guy with a beautiful date in a BMW and he honks his horn and he smiles at his girlfriend. He's got the chiclet white teeth and the tan and the full head of hair, and he doesn't even realize that he honked his horn at you. Have you ever fantasized about getting out of your car, dragging him out of his car, and with your fists pummeling his pretty face as his girlfriend watches and he's totally humiliated and she loses all respect for him? And he can no longer get it up for her, and they break up. And he, for the rest of his life, he remembers that moment when I got out of the car and beat him to a bloody pulp in front of his beautiful girlfriend. And he learned a lesson never to honk his horn again. Have you ever fantasized about that?
Partway, I feel like you fantasize like a pretty good movie outline.
No, that's the difference between men and women.
The more detailed screenplays?
Women don't fantasize about beating up a good-looking guy in front of the girlfriend.
Wouldn't our version be, we would fantasize about, if we're heterosexual, beating up a good-looking woman?
No, you don't do that.
Wouldn't that be my fantasy to be like, ugh, I'm going to beat the crap out of Blondie? Right.
But you don't have that fantasy.
Because women have that a lot.
No, they don't.
Oh, yeah, they do.
Women don't really visualize beating up somebody.
Yeah, we do.
Where you start salivating?
No, we're not. We're not dogs, David. But yeah, I think women have violent feel that's, yeah.
Not all the time.
Let's take caller 10.
Not all the time the way men do.
Okay, then not all the time. I mean, there is a testosterone difference between the two genders.
Do you enjoy watching mixed martial arts? Do you enjoy watching boxing?
No.
Right. And so most of the women who come...
But I also don't enjoy watching Real Housewives or other stuff that you might go, women, watch this.
I think most of the women...
Or like The Bachelor. Like, I don't watch The Bachelor, but like, that's something you would stereotypically say, well, women watch that. Also, that's kind of a woman's version of fighting, actually, now that we're on the topic, is... He's not going to like her because she's a this or that guy's a that. Like, it's sort of like with emotional, with relationshipy things, or like where women sort of fight more. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, I think women can figure out ways to hurt each other that men don't even realize that somebody's been hurt.
It would be more of like if you wanted to get back at a girl, I want... to have her ex call her on her the night before her wedding and beg her to come back. And so she calls off the wedding. And then when she gets to her ex, he's like, not really. Like, that would be like, that would be the female version of like what you were talking about. Like just beating a guy up. We're like, no, no. I want the deepest pain. I want it to hit her at her core. And she'll never forget, and she'll basically never smile again. That's what I want to do.
Yeah, see, I don't understand that. Do women...
it's more satisfying.
Do women... Because I...
Because bruises heal. Because David bruises heal. So if you beat up a guy, like, his beautiful face is going to grow back.
Yeah.
But if you destroy someone at their emotional core... What?
Let me ask you about women.
Okay.
Do you have
how many do you want, and how much money do you have?
Do you have close female friends?
Yes, a bunch.
Seriously.
Yes.
And do you get on the phone while your boyfriend is sitting there, and do you have a competition talking to your girlfriend to see who could be the most boring of the two? I have a theory. I have a theory that
what are you talking about?
I think women have conversations in front of their spouses or their boyfriends to see who can outbore the other.
Okay, that's not what they're doing.
They're talking, and you go, there's no way they could possibly be having this conversation, but for the reason of boring each other to death. This is hostility, this conversation.
So you're finding what they're saying boring, right? That's what's happening here? Why is your girlfriend on the phone while you're there? Why isn't she enjoying you?
Well, there you go.
That's not a good girlfriend. So to me, anything after that, she's not a great girlfriend.
Do women have to give a play-by-play of a relationship to their female friends?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. Yes. A couple of reasons. One, I would say, and I'm going out on a limb on all of this. I have not consulted other women. But when I talk to women about my relationship, and sometimes it's I mean, I just have very close friends. It's like, this is good, right? It's like, maybe I don't totally trust my, because your friends know if you're in a good relationship or not a good relationship. And
so then you have to tell all your secrets to them.
I tell a lot of things to some friends. And it's also, so if things take a turn, like let's say in 3 months, it's like we hit a rough spot and this or that happened. I'm not just going, hey, I've never told you this, but I've been dating someone for 3 months and it was really good until the blah, blah. It's like, so I'm current with someone and for one, you're sharing what's going on in your life. Another, hey, things are going well. I'm sharing this thing that's good. And then my friends are happy for me. Oh, this is so, I'm so glad you're with someone who appreciates you because I know you, that wasn't the case for so long.
All right, hang on. A, do you feel you're violating his privacy?
No, it's my relationship.
And discussing it with your friends. And B, do you really think they want your relationship to succeed, especially if they're not in one?
Yes, my friends do. Look, there are, I feel like you're talking about the shallow example of humanity and you're saying men are like this and women are like that. But there are lots of people who are really loving people and really good friends and who actually want something good to happen for their friends.
We're not talking about the gray areas. We're not talking about people on the margins. We're talking about real human beings. Do you think...
So a good, a loving person is on the margins.
Oh yeah, in this country, yes.
Okay, all right. Then I can't pull from my.
Hang on. You have a female friend, and you're talking about your relationship. If she is not in a relationship, how can you be 100% certain that she really cares whether or not your relationship succeeds? Don't you think it has to be filtered through her jealousy, her resentment, that you're having relations and somebody loves you? Don't you think she hates you and wants to sabotage your relationship because she's going to lose you to him?
No. But I'm trying to think like a shitty person. Because yes, if she's a shitty person and I'm a shitty person and that's why we're friends mostly, then yes, I can see how if I'm like, oh my God, I'm dating the greatest guy, he's an Oingo Boingo, she would be like, oh, that's great for you. And I wish I were dead.
I think Wattels, the gentleman who passed away, who invented the humble brag.
Harris Wattles.
I think when women are talking to their girlfriends about their boyfriends, it's a humble brag in that, oh, well, last night he wanted to have steak and I wanted to have lobster. So we went to Ruth Chris's steakhouse and they were all out of lobster. And I said, well, we can go someplace else. And he said, let's stay here. And I thought, well, he doesn't really care about my needs. And but what you're really saying to your friend is not that he ate steak when you couldn't eat your lobster. You're really saying, isn't my life great? And you're all alone watching Dancing with the Stars by yourself, eating Haagen-Dazs over the sink. You pathetic loser. I have a boyfriend. Isn't that what it's all about?
Yeah, you're right, David. That's that's totally what it's...
When yeah. a girl
guess,
is talking...
it is for a lot of people.
Huh?
I guess it is for a lot of people. I don't know. It seems like such a waste of life.
When you talk to your girlfriends about your boyfriend, it's kind of like complaining about your Maserati always needing to go into the shop.
I will admit, on my shittier side, I think with my last boyfriend... I was so impressed by him. I was excited to tell people about he was like shiny, impressive to me. And then with this one, I feel more like, oh my God, it is neat what he does and I respect it, but I'm just like, oh, I feel really good with this guy. I don't really care what anyone thinks.
But if you're intimate with somebody,
mm-hmm.
Shouldn't he or she trust that it's between the two of us?
I don't know. I'm a professional storyteller, so I nothing I do is ever going to be off limits for me to talk about if I feel like talking about it.
You have a girlfriend or a boyfriend, and they tell you something, how they feel about you.
Yeah.
For example, as you know, I like to tie a belt around my neck.
Yeah, yeah.
No, to heighten my bowel movements. It has nothing to do with sex, and I share that with you, right? Do I have to worry that you're going to go run to your girlfriends and say, hey, is this normal? I'm dating this really nice guy, David Feldman, and when he has to go to the bathroom, he borrows my belt so he can wrap it around his neck to heighten his bowel movements. He says it's better if he's getting less oxygen to the brain. It's a healthier BM. Would you tell that to your friends and ask them if that's normal?
Yes, 100%. And then
suppose I told you it's normal. Can't you take my word for it that it's normal?
Nope. Anyone who would get that information from you and just go, I mean, look, here's your unicorn is you find a woman who goes, oh my God, I do that too. Then you found your girl. Otherwise, literally everyone else is going to tell somebody, and I can tell you what that their response is going to be.
So it's kind of like being that gay man in the 50s. You have to live a quiet life and not discuss what you need with other people because it's going to, you're an open book. Everybody talks about everybody else, right?
I guess that's a way to think about it. I just think of it as like, to me, things I tell my best friend, like it's not like I'm betraying a confidence. I share my life with my friends, so I'm not, you know, like there's a level of telling people things that's gossip, and then there's a level that's like, yeah, I'm confiding in you, or I'm, you know, looking for support or whatever.
Maybe this is why we need to bring confession to the Episcopalians. I think if you were able to confess, you wouldn't need to go running to your girlfriends.
Yeah, maybe that was it.
Why do they have confession? Is it so people get things off their chest privately?
Well, I think in the Catholic Church there's confession because literally you have to confess your sins to like be forgiven. Otherwise you're not forgiven if you don't officially confess your sins.
But it's also because a release, right?
Yeah, because they also, you're not allowed to do that in there. What?
I find if I
wrap. Because they also give you penance of like, you know, say these prayers and et cetera, and then you'll be forgiven.
Well, this has been very interesting. I didn't think we would have anything to talk about, and we didn't get to what I really wanted to discuss.
Which is what?
I forgot. We were going to talk about something.
Stephen Hawking says Trump is murdering the earth, but what does he know?
What does he know about the earth? He's a big picture guy. He's all about the universe, but
yeah.
He doesn't know anything about specifics.
Yeah.
Is it Trump who's murdering the earth?
You know, that as part of pulling out of the climate accord and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
That you know, the other, like, I love that the big businesses are like, what? The earth is huge. That is so arrogant to think we're hurting earth. Such a weird. Anyway.
It's pretty scary, isn't it? What are you doing for July 4th? Today is July 4th. Do you feel free?
Yeah, I feel free. I mean, it's still a great country, even though there's so much wrong with it right now, particularly, and many things overall. But I feel pretty free. I am going to my I'm such a girl right now. I'm sorry. But my boyfriend, his quartet plays jazz at a rooftop restaurant in downtown LA every Tuesday. And it happens to fall on July 4th. So I'm going to that with a friend.
Okay, Emma Stone.
Yeah, it's the middle part of La La Land. That's where I'm at right now.
And when you get into a traffic jam, does everybody break out into song?
I hope so. Probably on the way down there. Yeah, we'll be like,
I love that movie.
Wasn't that catchy?
I love that movie. I do.
Oh, good. Then you're not dead inside.
I didn't say that.
Somehow it made its way through.
Now, I am fried, but I have to keep going. Does meditation unfry the brain?
Over time, it does. And in the immediate, it is a respite. It's a recharge. It's sort of the simplest visual sort of way to think of it. If you take like a jar, a clear jar of water, and you put some dirt in it and you shake it up, it's dirty, muddy water. And then you just set it down. And after a few minutes, like, it's clear, basically, because the dirt is settled. That's in a very cosmetic sense. That's sort of what you're doing when you meditate, is like you're getting still and your mind calms, which gives clarity. It gives rest. It gives recharge.
Yeah, I can't stop. That's the problem. Well, I wanted to this week. I was going to take this week off.
I could stop you.
Yeah?
You could do it because you're just doing it for like 3 minutes at a time, 5 minutes at a time. Like, what do you spend in the bathroom every day? Like 20, 30 minutes? Like, you have that time. What?
Huh?
So, yeah, you can take the time to meditate. And it's, you know, everything you're mad about is still going to be there.
I'm just trying to visualize you and I married.
Oh, God.
And I go, hey, I have to go to the bathroom. Where's my belt? And your eyes roll and you go, oh, I got to get out of this. I can't stand
it. First of all, I would have, if you've ever asked me that before, I would have just started hanging it where I hang the towels.
That's disgusting.
I would just be like, it's where the towels are. Why? You put it around your neck.
I don't want my belt. I don't want my belt in the bathroom where all the germs are. That's the same reason I don't leave my toothbrush in the bathroom.
That's unreasonable. That would be the weirdest part of your belt thing to me.
If I'm going to wrap a belt around my neck while I'm doing a BM, I want the belt to be clean. I don't want it sitting in a bathroom where strangers have been.
Then I would say, what strangers are going into your bathroom?
I would do this at a Greyhound station.
Okay, then that's... You're being so unreasonable, David.
You know, when we got married... Look,
your belt is wrapped in the Ziploc bag. It's put in the leather duffel, like it always is.
I explained to you.
And you know how the directions to the Greyhound bus station.
When we got married, I had one caveat, that I'm a normal Christian, white, heterosexual male.
Mm-hmm.
However, the only way I can relieve myself is a Greyhound bus station during rush hour.
Mm-hmm.
That was, and you accepted that. I explained that to you. Something happened to me when I was growing up.
I remember.
We had a greyhound, a dog, a greyhound, who once rubbed my nose in his own feces. Okay. Go ahead. You get the last word.
You're disgusting.
How do people reach you, Laura House? That was
Twitter,
perfect.
Twitter, I'm Laura House.
Yes. And are you on Facebook? Are you on Facebook?
Yeah, I'm on Facebook, but Twitter is more interesting for this sort of thing.
Okay.
And I have a monthly show at the Hollywood Improv called How to Hate Yourself. If you live in LA, come see it. We're doing one this Saturday at 7 with Dana Gould.
Wow.
How to Hate Yourself with Dana Gould. I could listen for hours.
And where is this at 7 o'clock on Saturday?
At the Improv.
That's a great show.
Yeah.
That's a great show. Wow. Stay on the line for 1 second.
All right.